The views expressed on the following program do not necessarily reflect the views of Money Radio staff, management, or advertisers, and do not represent an offer to buy or sell any securities. Some interviews heard on this program may be sponsored by the participants. It's time for Health Futures with Cypress Home Care Solutions, Bob Roth. This is Arizona's only show dedicated to providing you with expert advice on how to live a longer, healthier, and happier life. To learn more, call 602-264-8009. That's 602-264-8009. Now, here's your host, Bob Roth.
Good afternoon. You're listening to Health Futures, taking stock in you. I'm your host, Bob Roth. And it must be Friday, and indeed it is. It's the last Friday in July. It's hard to believe it. It is July 29th. We're coming at you live from the Scottsdale Air Park Studios of Money Radio, 1510 AM, 105.3 FM, and the World Wide Web, moneyradio1510.com. If this is the first time you're tuning into our show is about how our older adult population can live a healthier, happier life. And how do they do that? They do that by tuning in right here, not listening to me, but these extraordinary guests that I have here on the show. We've been on the air for about 9.5 years. And I've had almost 500 different guests, and today I have a special person. And when I talk about living a healthier, happier life, listening to Health Futures, this guy embodies this. And I'm just so pleased to have in the studio with me Jerry Svendsen. He is a super ager. Welcome to Health Futures, Jerry.
Bob, it's a delight to be with you. Glad to do it.
Well, it's good to be with you. And for our listeners, what is a super ager? Super agers are individuals who are age 80 and older and who are at greater risk for memory decline than individuals in their 70s or 60s. To be considered a super ager, you must be over the age of 80 and have memory performance at least good or better than individuals in the 50s and 60s. And I'll tell you, Jerry, I've met you. I think you have memory as good as someone in their 20s or 30s. It's really amazing. You are, and you embody what super aging is all about. So I'm so pleased to have you on the show, and I got lots of questions to ask.
Well, ask away, Bob. I'm glad to be here.
Well, I'll tell you what. Let's start off by telling our listeners a little bit about yourself.
Sure.
Because, you know, you are a well-known commodity or a well-known fixture, if you would, in the West Valley for those that were here when the entire Sun City development was built. So, you know, start a little bit before that, but please share with us what your activities with Del Webb and Sun City, and then from there.
Sure. Glad to do it. Well, I performed in several plays early on, The American Dream, Edward Albee, and I was in Hamlet, Laertes. And during the time I was in plays, I met a fellow by the name of Bob Aden. He was the director, and I told Bob that I was looking for something other than to selling time for Channel 3, and he said, Jerry, would you like to get into public relations work? And I said, oh, that sounds interesting. He introduced me to the senior vice president of the Del Webb Corporation, who sent me to the public relations department, and in November of 1961, the Webb Company invited me to go to Sun City, Arizona, to become their public relations representative.
And where'd you move from?
No, I was living in Phoenix.
So you were living in Phoenix. Oh, yeah. So you moved out to the Sun City area, or
no,
you did commuted?
No, I don't. Yeah, we commuted. We lived in Glendale.
So you met Del Webb.
Oh, definitely met Del Webb because Del Webb was like a god to the Sun City residents, and so he would come out and speak to the community. And when he did that, he'd come to our offices and walk around and meet all of the employees and chat with us and see how we were doing. And yeah, it was a pleasure to know the man. He was super.
Well, he's legendary, and I learned something from you earlier. I did not know he owned the New York Yankees.
He did, in the heyday, when they were all winning. They were winning championships on a regular basis.
Oh yeah, yeah. Back when Joe DiMaggio played, I would imagine. And yep. Mickey Mantle.
Yeah, well, when I was there, 60s. Yeah, 60s and 70s, but 60s is definitely.
Wow, no, and he's left his footprint. not just on our community, but so many communities. He was such a visionary. I mean, when you think about what he did with Sun City, it was amazing.
Yeah. Well, he built Christown. A lot of people don't know that some of the he started by building military bases. Luke Air Force Base was built by Del Webb.
Wow.
Yeah. So during World War II, he had a relationship with Franklin Roosevelt, and that relationship and got him some good work.
Oh, it did. Yeah. It did. So 1961. This was a vision that Del Webb had, this thing called Sun City.
Oh, actually, I was working at Channel 3, and there was a radio jingle, Wake Up and Live in Sun City for an Active New Way of Life. And I listened to that song, and I thought, wow, that's really interesting. Well, it ended up it was my school song, because I can sing the entire song for you, but here I was in Sun City early on. There, 2,500 people lived there when I went to work there in November of 61. And when I left in 82, we had a population of 47,700. So I had more grandparents than you can imagine.
I would imagine.
Because I interviewed a lot of those people and would send stories to their hometown newspapers as a promotion for the Del Webb Company. And so I did a lot of that, a lot of public speaking. I would hire people at the Sun City Sun Bowl when it opened. The Lions clubs would be the ushers and ticket takers, but
yep.
I just worked closely with people who were 20, 30 years older than me. As I went from 26 to 36 to 46, they were 65, 75, 85. And I felt like they were contemporaries. I never felt that they were old people by any means, because the way they lived their lives.
Right. I almost feel the same way. That's why I'm in the older adult business, aging adult business. It's just so gratifying, because I think everyone I meet is like a good book, and they've lived a great life, and the stories are endless.
Absolutely. Yeah. Life has really been, I tell you what, life has really been good for me. Between 65 is when I retired, but then I was still doing retirement planning seminars for SRP employees as a discussion leader, and I left that when I was 75. And right along, I found things that I love to do, and I think that's more important than anything. Do you, and look for what turns you on in life and keep doing it.
No doubt. And, you know, one of the things that we've learned is that it is so important to have these social connections.
Oh, absolutely.
And you are, you know, you're so affable, and you're easy to approach, and you have really strong interpersonal skills. And you know, one of the things that I learned along the way, it's more important to be interested versus interesting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you're genuinely interested in me and anyone you approach. I mean, it's very obvious by the engagement and the questions
right.
that come from you.
Well, how do we learn? We don't learn what we already know. That's why it's important for us to ask questions of people. Actually, early on in life, I didn't have that skill, and found out later on, if you went out with a young lady and you really liked her, ask her about herself. Don't be thinking about you. But
right.
that's life in general. Talk to people and ask them about them. You know, don't tell them how great you are or anything else. I mean, you learn by listening.
Exactly. And, you know, everybody likes to talk about themselves,
absolutely.
Right? Absolutely. But they just want to be given that opportunity and that permission to do so.
Why do you think I wanted to come on the air and talk about Jerry?
Yeah,
you bet.
Yeah, you didn't ask me. I asked you. I asked you.
I know.
But, you know, what's interesting is, you know, I watched a TED Talk recently, Dr. Robert Waldinger. He's a psychiatrist over at Harvard. And he did an amazing TED Talk, you know, really talking about, you know, aging and really what keeps us healthy and happy as we go through life. And, you know, one of the things he shared, and it's really concerning, and, you know, I really want to put this out there to our listeners, not so much to you, but I want you to comment on it too. And that is, you know, they surveyed the millennials, right? This generation that mm-hmm. is just ahead of the Gen Zs. So they're, you know, 25 to, you know, I'm going to say 25 to 35, give mm-hmm. or take. You know, and ask them, you know, where would you put, you know, basically they said, what is the most important goal in your life? And you ready for this, Jerry? 80% of them said their life goal is to make money. Seriously, that's what they said. That's their life goal, 80%. And 50% of those 80% said they want to become famous. what's wrong with this picture?
Well, yeah, I don't. Yeah.
What's wrong with this picture?
I don't know how many people with that in mind, whether how many of them will live. I just don't think that's the
no.
We should have that.
No, and he talked about the 75-year now it's probably 82-year-old study that Harvard has done,
uh-huh.
and they had all these people enrolled in it back 82 years ago, yeah. And one of the things that they really realized was that. The clearest measure when they were polling these people was about their relationships and really, what makes them happy and healthy, and really engaging in these relationships and really talking about social connections and how important those are. And I know, that's something that really is your bread and butter and something that you really do.
I do it, but I have to say that I believe that the actuarial tables indicate that women outlive men. And I think that women have much more socialization in the later years than men do.
No question.
And now, is it any wonder that they're alone, so many of them?
Exactly. We're at our first segment right. Down. We got three more to go. You're listening to Bob Roth, and Jerry Svendsen's in the office or in the house. We're talking super aging. Stick around. We'll be right back.
Now back to Health Futures. Taking stock in you. If you have questions about your own or your loved one's future health care, call 602-264-8009. Now, here's your host, Cypress Home Care Solutions, Bob Roth.
Welcome back. You're listening to Health Futures Taking Stock in You. I'm your host, Bob Roth, and if you're just tuning in, we're in our second segment here. I'm proud to have in the studio with me Jerry Svendsen, and one of the things I left off when I did the intro for you, Jerry, in the first segment, is that my connection to you mm-hmm. is your son, Cameron.
Oh, Cameron.
Cameron Svendsen.
Yeah, right.
And I got to tell you.
Good guy.
Yeah, he's not a bad guy.
We raised him up that way, of course.
Yeah.
Takes after his dad. Don't tell Linda that.
and he's been on the show before. And, one of the things that I really love about Cameron is he cares. He really cares. And
you can't do that job.
And not.
Exactly. And you, not. Bob, so, yep. you know that.
Yep. But, well, he has, he's involved in hospice, faith hospice, and then he's got the palliative care.
Palliative care.
Yeah, so, I mean, he really is, very connected to the clients or patients that he serves. And
personable.
Well, and that business is.
Exactly. You have to have that in order to be effective,
And you're dealing with families at a crisis time, and they are dealing with all kinds of emotions, right? And they don't really know where to go, what to see, who to contact. It's really a gift that he has.
Yeah,
and I can see he probably gets that from you.
I'm sure of that. But Linda, I'm 87, Linda's 82, and we do see challenges coming for ourselves. And push them, denial, push them into the future. And not meaning to do that, of course. But we're so immersed in life and so healthy because of that. We are definitely what you called super agers because mentally, physically, spiritually, socially, you name it, we're into life. And a lot of that had to do with the work that I've done over the years. And working with older adults in my own way has been very interesting and effective.
So our listeners can't see you. I can. I mean, you are very fit. You are slim. You really take care of yourself. So
thank you.
Can you share with our listeners, what does the typical day look like or typical week look like for Jerry Svendsen?
Well, physical fitness to me, diet and fitness mean a lot, and I'm either swimming when I can go to the stadium and walk the steps. I'll do my 500 steps. If not, then I'll do the treadmill. And the swimming, of course, is in endurance. And then I also do some lifting, and I do that at least 5 days a week that I'm spending time in a fitness program. But I've learned, and I don't know if it was you or Cameron, you and I have talked. And the whole idea of getting a good night's sleep, hydrating, Sugars are not good if you don't go to bed on sugar.
Mm-hmm.
But a whole lot of things that have given me the quality that I continue to have.
And was this something that you were
always
reading up on? Is this something that, you know, somebody told you to do, or is this something that was innate in you? Have you been doing this since your 20s, or did you start this after you retired at 65?
There's a saying: press forward, do not stop, do not linger in your journey, but strive for the mark set before you. I have always been interested in being as healthy as I can be, and so it's just I'm born and bred that way, I guess. But I think this is why I'm 87 and still in good
right.
health, because I am conscientious about it.
And you know, you use the phrase, and I think it's something that people use often, and they use it in the wrong context. I mean respect, not disrespect, but people talk about diet, right? You know, diets are fads. They come and go. It's more of a lifestyle, right? It's what you've chosen to eat. So you're not, you know, starving for something that you want.
Not at all. Absolutely.
And it is amazing to me.
That's true.
And my wife Susie talks about it all the time, is that when you eat a clean diet, it makes you feel good.
Oh, absolutely. I'm not talking about some unusual, you know.
Right.
I eat apricots and strawberries and blueberries, oatmeal. I generally want to start out with protein in my system, because I know I'm going to be doing exercise. So I eat black beans. I eat yogurt in the morning. Plain organic yogurt. Almonds, and so I really look at the protein, and then the fruit, and obviously, Linda and I love our salads and our green vegetables, broccoli. You know,
love it.
Yeah,
love it. And
spinach.
And occasionally, do you venture off and have a steak? Do you venture off and have a big piece of
No, if I have an opportunity to have salmon, I'll go with the salmon. I tend to be more fish. Linda and I will have some red meat. And very little, and some pork, but generally it's going to be fish, chicken, and that's just kind of what we've done.
So talk about beverages for me. You know, you drink a lot of water. You brought yourself some Perrier.
Perrier. There's water in there today, though.
Yeah.
But I drink some Perrier. Basically, I try to drink 8 glasses of water a day.
Mm-hmm.
Stop at 7 o'clock at night, because I don't want to get up at several times during the night. And I get a better night's sleep.
Oh, I'm sure you do.
One of the things that I've—I don't know how this has happened, but I don't go to bed with problems. I put them aside and I fall asleep. And for some reason, I don't know how it's happened, but I'm able to get a very good night's sleep without having dreams or.
What is that secret? How do you put away those problems? Do you do a breathing exercise? Do you cleanse your mind? Are you doing yoga? What is that secret, Jerry? Because sometimes some of us can't turn our brains off, right? You know, we're sitting there and we're either exhausted and we pass out, or we are just constantly thinking.
Yeah, well, some of that may be getting you're on the social media, you're on Facebook, and maybe you're doing these things, or watching television, and the blue light in television supposedly is not good. So I tend to now, I'd rather do some reading, light reading, before going to bed. I don't watch the TV, I don't watch the news, because you know what's going on out there in the world. I certainly am aware of it, and think about that. But no, I just have made the decision. I don't know how that happens. You know, it's not scientific here, and just determine. Okay, Jerry, time to shut it off, and I shut it off.
What time do you get to bed?
Usually 10 o'clock.
10 o'clock, and mm-hmm. and you're up to rise.
Yeah, I don't. Interestingly enough, 6 hours is good for me, so I'm up by 4:30 or so.
About 4:30
yeah,
or so.
That's when I swim in the mornings and get my swim in. And I think the fasting idea is good. I think you've talked about this. What is it? 12 hours of fasting isn't a bad thing. You stop eating at 7 or 8 o'clock at night, and you don't eat anything until 7 o'clock in the morning. You can hydrate, of course.
Oh, yeah.
So it's good.
There you go. And that is really good. I need to learn that, Jerry. I mean, especially, you know, I drink so much water, and it's hard to stop at 7.
Absolutely.
How many times are you getting up
at night?
I still
take a swig, you know, maybe twice.
Twice a night.
Yeah, but again, it's one of those things where I go back to bed and I conk out.
There you go. But 87, and I mean, you're really doing the super aging that I'm talking about.
Yeah, thank you.
Well, and so much of it is about attitude. And, you know, one of the things I want to get into in our third segment is that you shared with me before we started, you shared with me the fact that you had done, you know, theater and performance, and you do a lot of public speaking. So you're not shy of the mic, and it's the first time you've been on the radio, but I mean, you've had the mic
a long
time. But one of the things that you shared with me is that, you know, so much of it is your attitude, and I really want to, you know, dig into that in the third segment, because you do a lot of laughing, you do a lot of singing, you do a lot of that stuff that really, you know, it puts you in a good mindset.
It does. And be a childlike adult, and we can talk a little bit about that and how you do that.
A childlike adult.
The songs that I sing that have to do with laughter and play and joy.
So I know the audience can hear a little Jason Mraz has taken us out in the first half. Give me just a little bit of a song that you know we can leave with our listeners to tee up the third segment.
If I want my youth forever, it's a habit. All I have to do is nab it. I won't be adultish. I'm growing so young. I'm feeling resilient as this song is sung.
Now back to Health Futures, taking stock in you. If you have questions about your own or your loved one's future health care, call 602-264-8009. Now, here's your host, Cypress Home Care Solutions, Bob Roth.
Welcome back. You're listening to Health Futures, Taking Stock in You. I'm your host, Bob Roth. And if you're just tuning in, we're in our second segment here. We're coming at you live from the Scottsdale Air Park studios of Money Radio, 1510 AM, 105.3 FM, and the World Wide Web, moneyradio1510.com. And if you're just tuning in, I have got in the studio with me, I got Jerry Svendsen. He's 87 years old. He is what I've defined as a super ager. He has got the greatest mindset you could ever imagine and his outlook on life. And, you know, during our break, he and I were having some conversation, and he referenced the fact that, you know, one of the ways that really has enabled him to do what he's doing is living in the moment.
Absolutely.
So I would love for you to tell our listeners a little bit about what does that mean, living in the moment, right?
Yeah. Living in the moment is... it's a miracle. Each moment is a miracle, and each day is a beautiful one. As far as living in the moment, each moment is a gift to me. I open the present right now. Every second I'm feeling free and loving life and how. And I sing an entire song about that. But we are takers of life for granted and should realize that every single second of conscious life is a miracle past reckoning, a marvel past all computation. There are no ordinary moments, and John Cowper said that.
Wow.
But there's a lot of that sort of thing that I have up here in my head that I like to share with people, what others have to offer. What I like to do is learn from everyone from Marcus Aurelius to Charles Fillmore to well-known.
Harvey McKay, we were talking
Harvey
about.
Harvey McKay,
yeah.
Absolutely. And then share that with other people.
Right.
And people who are gone. They may be gone, but their words still live. And I want to help those to live beyond me by sharing them. So
you know, you mentioned living in the moment. And, you know, we talked about at the very beginning of the show, we talked about this study that Harvard had done.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, one of the things that this Dr. Robert Waldinger did was he surveyed these millennials, and 80% of them were focusing on money, and 50% of them were on fame. And, you know, you talk about living in the moment, and, you know, social media, as great as it has been, and these devices, I mean, it's a great way to connect with people, but You know, I went to a concert the other night. I went and saw James Taylor.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Yeah. The original JT. Not, you know, Justin Timberlake, who is very good. But, James
not the same.
James Taylor, 74 years old, and he was out there jamming and doing a great job. But how many people were there that had their phones up and they were recording him and not being in the moment, not singing to his songs,
oh,
you know, just trying to capture it? I mean, somebody else is capturing that for you. I mean, do you really capture it in your mind, right?
No,
just be there in that moment.
Really important, because it's going by. You and I sit here for an hour together. We're gone. We're into something else. But as far as I'm concerned, this is the most important day of my life. It's special, because it never will come back again. You can. The only way you can repeat it is by repeating today, today, today. Otherwise, it's gone at midnight. And so I look at this, and then I always mark on my calendar highlights of my day.
Nice.
This is a highlight of my day, Bob. I want you to know.
Well,
that.
I want you to know it's a highlight of mine too. I've been looking forward to having you here on the show.
Right. Well, good to be here.
And you know, you sung us a little verse to end our second segment right at the first half. And you know, one of the things that you shared with me when we had that lunch together last month was you talked about how laughter and singing is really the root of happiness and really living in the moment. Can you share a little bit more with us on that?
Well, it's to me, it's being a healthy person is also being lighthearted, and I think, and more laughter in our lives, and we don't get enough of that. We went out the other night with another couple, and one of us had a story, and we were laughing so hard we were in tears. Well, that doesn't happen very often.
No.
So. I don't know where I learned it, but I learned the I Love to Laugh song, and I sing I Love to Laugh loud and long and clear. And I can sing the whole song, but by the time I'm finished with it, I've had a health mechanism, because if you think about belly laughs, what do they do for you? Starts with the lungs, goes to the heart, heart muscles working,
right.
It goes to the abs. You know, this T cells for what is it, the system, you also have the endorphins that kick in,
right.
and there goes the stress.
You're talking about autoimmune system.
The immune system,
yeah.
The T cells.
Yeah.
So these are all things that the deep belly laughs can, they're very, very good.
Well, I think you forgot one other piece.
Helpful.
Yeah, what other organ is their brain? It's so helpful for your brain. I mean, it puts you in a good mood. And, you know, you talked about going to bed, right? And going to bed with a clear mind. And you talked about not watching the
Turn
news.
Turn off all the devices.
Yeah, because the news isn't good.
No.
I mean, there's nothing good that's on the news. I mean, we learn about the divisiveness in politics. We learn about the murders that are happening.
And climate change. And so much of this we can't. And inflation. And
right.
All things that we can't do. I mean, those are big.
They are big.
But
we can't let them wear us down.
Well, when you're 87 or any age, but as we're going through our lives, it almost seems to escalate the situation with you're using what's left of you, and if you're out there letting things that you can't do anything about get to you, so let that go, and find some meditation. So if we think about mind. And taking care of mind, body, spirit, emotions, and senses. They're part of our who we are.
They're part of our who we are, our psyches, and really how we exist.
Exactly.
Absolutely. And you know,
dimensions of us.
I said this in the first segment. You know, social connections are so good for us. You know, our connections to family, friends, and community. Are really how people are living longer. And you know, Jerry, one of the biggest challenges we have as a society is that one third of our population across the nation is living home alone, 65 and older.
Mm-hmm.
And loneliness is definitely a killer. And you know, I know we have listeners that are listening to the show, and most of our listeners are between the ages of about 30 and 70. And whether it be those that are aging or those that are loved ones of aging, you know, adults, you know, sons and daughters, you know, that may have a parent that is living home alone, either through divorce or widow to widowers.
Mm-hmm.
How do we get them to see that, right? We have
yeah,
we have
yeah.
about a minute in this segment,
yeah.
but I, You know, I'm putting you on the spot, but I mean, so much of what you do and what you describe is these social connections. And you know, you have Miss Linda that has been your lifelong partner, and you know, you're able to do these things with other couples and with her.
Yeah, well, that and we have our pets. You know, we always have our cats and dogs. Yeah, well, it's just essential to have that. Going out for coffee with a friend, and getting together and enjoying each other, it's really good. I don't have an answer to it other than the social is very important. I think the thing you just said is getting the word out to those who are alone. We need to reach out to people. When I'm out shopping or at a restaurant, wherever I'm meeting people, I can either strike up something that's a bit funny or compliment or whatever. And it's interesting, when we walk around with a smile on our faces, we're much more likely to get a smile back.
Oh yeah.
And also, you'll also get it. Oh, good morning, or hello. You know. So I think it really, and it behooves us to do this, because we might be passing people who are struggling in their lives, not being recognized, and all of a sudden somebody's saying hello to me. So I think being very much aware of our fellows, other than ourselves, is really important.
And you brought up a great point. I mean, it's so true. We have no idea what some people are going through, and sometimes just a hello can bring a smile to someone's face. And you know, I've said it here on the show too. You know, with 1/3 of our population 65 and older living home alone, you know, if you know of someone like that, you know, don't ask to help. Just do, because if you ask, they're just gonna say, you know, I'm sorry. So, if you're cooking two casseroles, are you cooking a casserole for dinner? Cook two, and just drop one off and say, I was thinking of you. I made you dinner.
Right.
You hear the music. We're down three segments, Jerry. It goes really, really fast.
It does.
Do you have a song you can take us out on this third segment?
Let's see. Okay. Oh, give us a day filled with laughter and play from dawn till we hit the hay. We'll laugh and we'll sing, we'll do everything. When it's over, we'll wish we could stay.
We're down three segments. We got one more left. Jerry Svendsen's in the house. We'll be right back.
Now back to Health Futures, taking stock in you. If you have questions about your own or your loved one's future health care, call 602-264-8009. Now, here's your host, Cypress Home Care Solutions, Bob Roth.
Welcome back. You're listening to Health Futures Taking Stock in You. I'm your host, Bob Roth, and if you're just tuning in, we're in our fourth segment. I've got Jerry Svendsen in the house with me. He is a super ager, 87 years old. If you missed the first three segments, go up to our website at cypresshomecare.com. Click on the media button. The radio show button is right below that. You'll find this show and nearly 500 others that we've done over the last 9.5 years. So, Jerry, you ended that third segment with a song. I would love for you to open up this fourth segment with the chorus to that song, because, you know, you said that the key is to find the childlike person that's inside of you.
Laugh, smile, and play. Tools for wellness that pay. They'll help the whole being and social agreeing. We're friendly, we're funny, let's play. That was a part of our laughter and play getaway that Carol Secord and I conducted. And interestingly enough, we invited people 70 and over to go to the getaway, this laughter and play getaway. And the only people who signed up were women, 70 and over, and we just had such a good time. We went up to Emory-Riddle University.
Oh, yeah.
They gave us some space,
nice. And
we just had a three-hour laughter and play and games that we used to play as younger people. And we just need to find more play in our lives and more joy and more fun.
Right.
And so...
We all have that inside of us, right? I mean, we still feel like a child. I mean, I do.
I'm just a kid again, doing what I did again.
Well,
absolutely.
I love how you said that. I tell Susie, she not only raised three daughters, but she raised a son. I mean, I'm a kid too. I mean,
you know what? Fairy tales can come true, can happen to you if you're young at heart. So if you can find the young in there and live that way. Am I old? No. When I was 65 and I was still working at the magazine, I would go out with the 30 and 40 year olds. I never thought about myself as an older person. And they, I'm sure they never, I was just one of the contemporaries. We were working together. And that's the way we need to look at older adults. Yeah. And don't paint them all with the same brush. I'm walking down the street at my regular pace, and a guy's standing across on the other side. And as I'm walking, he looked across me and said, "How do you walk that fast?" And I said, "What do you mean, how do I walk that fast? I'm only 85. And he said, "That's remarkable."
But you walk in with intention.
I walk with intention. Linda walks with intention.
Yeah.
I mean, she sits down and plays bridge for hours, and she reads a lot, and she does a lot of sedentary, what I would think would stop her. No, get out of my way. When we go to the mall, I have to keep up with Linda, you know. So, and we, when we, the escalator, I wait till it clears so I can do the steps. I want to walk up. I don't loaf.
Right.
No way.
No, I love that.
I move.
You get your steps in for sure.
Oh, absolutely.
You get your, you know,
one,
you,
step at a time.
You said something at the break too.
Skip some time too.
Yeah, I love that. You said something at the break. You talked about quantity versus quality, and you know, I'd love for you to just dig a little deeper into that, because I mean, you certainly have gotten the quantity, but you've lived your life about quality.
Well, yeah, but. Where is the quality? The quality is when we were talking, you know, my song, "Today Is Here, Jer, This Your Reminder. It's what you make it, it's up to you. It's what you're thinking and what you do. I'll make it a great age, I'm growing new." So it's all about where we are, Bob, here in this room now together, but then throughout this day, being so aware of our surroundings, see the trees, see the sky. Turn off the radio, turn off all the equipment, and look around. For one thing, you'll be a safer driver as well.
Yes, you will.
You know, I'm thinking how people are just constantly busy on their equipment when we're driving. You know,
it's so
pay attention.
It's so true. I will say this. I mean, I used to get my best ideas and thoughts when I was driving in the car. And there was nothing on. And now we have, you know, not only, you know, thousands of stations, we've got podcasts, we've got all, we got the phones.
Yeah.
But I still, you know, there are times where I drive home and I turn everything off. And we need to do more of that. It's, there's no problem being alone in your thoughts, right?
No, no, none whatsoever. Now, you have all the equipment, all of the accoutrements, all of the abilities. If you're taking a walk nowadays, you can have a thought that just says, "Wait a minute, that's a great idea." Well, I don't have any of that. So I'm walking along and I'm thinking, "Oh yeah, this and this. And I get home and I've left it back there. But now it's interesting. I need to get Cameron, my son, to help me with some of the ways that I can grab onto my ideas, because I do have some good, still have some good stuff that I can share with people.
Well, and you know, and certainly sharing them with Cameron and certainly documenting them is really important. But
I have, you know, that's one of the things I've wanted to do, more public speaking. I'd be happy to come over to Glencroft or any place and give a little talk and do some singing and entertainment. But I have so much that I've written. That's in there in my computer, and Cameron will eventually see it, and which is fine. But isn't it nicer to be able to go out and do your thing? And that's what I missed that at 87.
Well, we need to get you back doing that. I had someone from Glencroft in here a couple months ago, so I may have to connect the two of you.
Yeah, well, that'd be great. Love it. I'm not going to Glencroft soon, though. But I'll go over there and speak.
No, that's what I'm talking about. I'm not talking about being a resident. I'm just talking about going over to speak.
Okay, that's fine.
And really sharing this positive energy and the mindset that, you know, living in the moment is so important.
Right.
So I got to tell you, Jerry, we're at the point now where we just have about a minute and a half, and we're getting ready to wind down. And, you know, I want to ask you, is there any question I haven't asked, or is there any lasting thoughts you want to leave with our listeners? And I'm definitely going to have you back, because I have a whole list of things I still want to get through with you.
Charles Fillmore started the faith movement of the Christian church. And one day he was in the pulpit and he looked out at his congregation and he said, "I want you to know that I fairly sizzle with zeal and enthusiasm, as I spring forth with a mighty faith to do the things that ought to be done by me. And what Charles Fillmore was telling his parishioners is that I may be 93 years old, but I'm not leaving anytime soon. And that's why I feel, find what you love to do, as Charles Fillmore was doing, and keep doing it. That's why I was glad to get on the air with you, because finally it gives me a voice.
I love it.
Other than talking to myself every day in the house.
No, I love it. I shared with you, I had a guest on the show about 6 years ago, 5 years ago, Dr. Avery Weissman, and he was on the show before his 103rd birthday. And, I asked him the question, what was the key to living up to 103? He was 102 at the time. And he said, I'm not afraid to die, and I'm not focused on it.
No.
I'm focused on living, and you're a great example of somebody that focuses on living.
There's a 100-year-old man who's written a book, and he's titled it My First 100 Years, An Interim Report. So you see, this guy lived to 103, and we know people who's living 106, 7, and they're still mentally right there.
They are, and absolutely. You know what? They're super-aging it like
super-aging.
Jerry Svendsen's doing, and Jerry, I can't thank Cameron enough for putting the two of us together, and it's been a pleasure meeting you and getting to know you, and I know I speak for our listeners. You have shared some great stuff with us.
Glad to hear
it. I'm going to digest it, and I'm going to live a more fuller and happier life, and I'm not sure you're going to catch me singing in the car like you do, but I might.
Maybe better.
I might, and I might be walking the street, and you might see me singing, and you can just give that credit to Jerry Svendsen.
Bob, you've been good for me, let me tell you. Well, I appreciate you.
Well, I'm circling my calendar today. You certainly made my day today. Make it a great day. Have a great weekend. We'll be back next Friday. Thank you for joining us.
There's no place like home. You've been listening to Bob Roth's Health Futures. If you have questions about your own or your loved one's future health care, call Cypress Home Care Solutions at 602-264-8009. That's 602-264-8009. Or visit cypresshomecare.com. Be sure to join Health Futures with Bob Roth every Friday at noon, right here on Money Radio 1510 and 105.3 FM.